You're on a ship, traveling through the galaxy, on your way to a place only known by few. This is the Obscurus Galaxy, a small collection of stars on the outer limits of space, unknown and undisturbed by many explorers. Some come looking for this place, but they'll only ever reach its outer limits. The stars drift from time to time, sometimes towards the Cultus Galaxy, where they're nurtured by a small collective of space travelers and are able to shine for a little longer. Most, though, are lost to the darkness of this vast vacuum. Covered up, unfinished, or just plain forgotten. I'll be taking you on a journey into this place, where we'll discover one of the most blackened stars in the entire musical universe. Its story? Untold. Its conception? Uncertain. And its origin? Unknown. But to discover all of that, we need to go back. Far back.
The civil rights picture of those years was one of violence.
Glenn Lamont Goins, born on January 2nd, 1954, was raised in Plainfield, New Jersey, by his mother and father, names unfindable. Both were devotedly religious and musical, being intensely into gospel, which influenced Glenn from a young age. Picking up the guitar was a rite of passage for Goins, who learnt it by ear and was heavily influenced by great blues, gospel, and jazz guitarists. His first performances were with his siblings in a youth gospel group that travelled all over New Jersey and New York, Pennsylvania, and Maryland during the mid and late 1960s. The travels proved beneficial to him, as he refined his vocal and playing skills along the way with each passing gig. What set Glenn apart from his siblings, and would later go on to chill audiences, was his gravelly, raw, and powerful gospel tenor voice that he could reach a wide range of octaves with. Raspy crackles and scratches that culminated in his throat gave him a greater power over fellow singers, with a strength that was unique to him and him alone. In his late teens, Glenn Goins performed alongside other soul rock groups, but it wasn't until one rainy night in an underground bar, its name lost to time, that he'd begun to sing with enough power, light, and force to begin transcending into stardom. Gary Scheider was a fellow guitarist, an explorer who had heard of a forming star close by. Tracking it down through the vast expanse, he heard the strong and distinctive voice and alerted the Big P, the P standing for planet, obviously. George Clinton was this Big P. Through Gary Scheider, he discovered Glenn, and once Glenn sang, there was no other in George's mind that was stronger to join his newly formed crew of fantastical funketeers who were preparing to blast off into the cosmos. Glenn would join this long-haired, colourful captain, making his first appearance on Chocolate City in 1975. Come the late part of the year, Captain Clinton pushed Glenn into full force, with Glenn's masterful and majestic churchified voice being the only tool strong enough to bring down the mothership.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, all engines running. Mike
Smith,
liftoff, we have liftoff. The tower is clear.
And we have a roll for me.
Okay. You have liftoff on all pilots.
Thank you.
1976. Glenn Goins tears the roof off the Houston Summit on Halloween night, in a passionate and powerful performance of pure perfection. The crowd is silent, and swaying anonymously in the dark, as his voice alone calls out into the pitch-black auditorium, summoning the mothership from above, and making history in the process. Do you wanna fly, Houston? Do y'all wanna fly this evening? Let me ride. Put your hands together, y'all. Sweet chestnut, let me ride. Swing down, sweet chestnut, let me ride. Somebody help me sing, y'all. Let me ride. After the mothership comes, let me ride. There will be no second coming. Let me ride. Sing, swing down. Come on, you stand, y'all. Let me ride. Come on, sing, y'all. Sweet cherry stop and let me ride. Somebody help me, Lord. Sweet cherry stop. Yeah, let me ride. Swing down. Yeah. Wait a minute. Let me ride. I think I see the mothership coming in, Lord. Let me ride. I think I hear the mothership coming in. Glenn would continue to bring the mothership down until the recording sessions for Funkadelic and One Nation Under a Groove came along. Many members within Parliament-Funkadelic, including Glenn, were tired of not being paid in full by leader George Clinton. Their hard work created the smashing success. And now, it wasn't being appreciated. Many key members to the group eventually left the mothership and created their own groups, taking with them what they knew and hoping they would fare well alone. some did well. Others, not so much. But Glenn wouldn't be left in either of those categories. He had something bigger, better, and brighter in mind.
There it is.
Okay, let's start a little bit earlier. The year is 2005. I'm young. I go to a school in a tiny village, up the road from which is an old abandoned factory of some sort. No one really has a definitive answer of what it used to be, but even now in the year 2020, it's still somehow there.
So here's the building. Not really sure what I'm meant to say about it, to be honest, because I mean it is just an abandoned building, but let me tell you a little story.
The school decided to take us for a walk one day. That just so happened to lead past this building that I, until that moment, didn't know about. As a child, your world is pretty confined. It's small. Tiny. You know your home, maybe a few little routes to places, but you really don't get to explore too much because your parents are keeping an eye on you. Maybe that's why so many of us look forward to going on school trips, because we get to go on an adventure to an unknown place. I've always loved that, and this building seemed to capture my imagination and intrigue. But this place was just the first surrealistic building I'd be enchanted with. It was around 6 miles away, but the second would make an even greater impact.
Stand by. Game commencing in 3, 2, 1. Red versus blue. Play. Experience all the zones. Quazar.
It was, is, was a chain of popular laser tag arenas and arcades located all over the UK and other countries. We had one in my city, which I really wanted to visit, but couldn't as I was too small to do anything inside. In 2005, the place eventually closed, leaving behind a vague and faded shell of a building that got abused as the years went on. The memories of those who went in, fading away with the logo. Around 2009, my obsession with abandoned buildings and repeating the word derelict over and over again had been started, and the abandoned laser tag in town captured my attention. But that's all it needed to keep me obsessed. Over the years, the building kept getting worse and worse. The smudged and dusty glass doors let you glimpse inside, only to reveal a still-running vending machine filled with what I can only remember to be Red Bull to your left. Beyond that, the place was pitch black and a mystery. You couldn't see into the building at all. Go around the front and you'd see the old sign for the building, vaguely still spelling the alien word Quazar, with its broken neon signage hanging on by wire after vandals somehow ripped some off. I don't know why, I don't know how, but this building kick-started a lifelong interest in abandoned buildings and locations from nearby and across the globe in me. And the alien word, to a young boy, was just as mysterious as what went on inside the building, which his parents never really let him know. Skip ahead to the year 2012. I'm in secondary school, and it's not the nicest place. Both physical and verbal bullying is constant, as I'm a different kind of boy with long blonde hair who has a fascination with the 1970s and 80s. On this specific day, I'm hiding in an IT classroom during the lunch break alone. Music is an important thing to me. My favourite artists at the time are all from the 70s. Bee Gees, Boney M, Earth, Wind & Fire, and Heatwave, just to name a few. I'm listening to them as I get an idea. Recently, the Quazar building signage, by this point iconic to me, has been taken down, and the place is undergoing redevelopment into student flats. After years of not really knowing what the place looked like before closure, and wanting to know, my curiosity finally got the better of me and I decided to research it. The first thing to come up, however, wasn't my favourite abandoned building, but an album named Quazar by a band with the same name. The logo alone was striking, so I gave one of the tracks a listen. Was like nothing I'd ever heard before. The vocals were crazy and all over the place, the beat was heavy and strangely energetic, not to mention this coarse and crackly gospel voice that came in underneath all the instruments with an unheard grittiness. I turned it off halfway through because, if I'm honest, I didn't like it at first. It wasn't as safe as all the other disco I enjoyed. It was energetic, mad, and almost unlistenable to a 1970s collector who didn't yet understand what this was. By late 1976, Glenn Goins had left Parliament-Funkadelic and was now together with other musicians, some of whom declared mutiny on the Mama Ship. Glenn pulled in various other faces, both old and new, to create his own group, which he had yet to decide a name for. While the name remained a mystery, the members were set in stone. Kevin Goins, his brother, on guitar and lead vocals, Eugene Jackson on bass, lead and background vocals, Richard Banks manned the keyboards and added background vocals along with Greg Fitz, Jeff Adams, drums, background vocals, Harvey Banks, guitar, background vocals, Daryl Dixon, saxophone, clarinet, flute, Monica Peters, trumpet, Daryl Deliberto, congas, Daniel Brack, background vocals, and spiritual leaders? What on earth, Wikipedia? With a name now set in stone, and a group of exceptional soul, rock, gospel, blues, and funk lovers ready to hit the stage, Quazar was born, performing live as an album was on the horizon. The group wrote, played some live shows, and by the fall of 1977, they began recording. It was at this time when a new member of the group, Pete Jenner, entered their galaxy. I managed to get in contact with her for an interview. What inspired you to get into the group? What did you do before it?
Glenn had a vision for Quazar, and I wanted to be a part of the musical team. I had just finished performing in the a cappella off-Broadway show Seasons Reasons, and had just broken up with my boyfriend. I was eager to do something new.
What were Glenn and the group like to work with?
First of all, I liked the ideas that Glenn had for us. He envisioned us as a younger offshoot of Bootsy's Rubber Band and Parliament Funkadelic, and he created songs for us that parodied them. He also had a vision of blending R&B, funk music with gospel music, and he was one of the first producer/songwriters to incorporate gospel lyrics into our songs. He saw me as a younger version of Grace Jones, who was very popular then, and asked me to shave my hair off, which I gladly did. I had my own personal barber who came to my apartment to shave my head every 3 months. When I started rehearsing with the band, I liked our sound and our camaraderie. After a while, I wasn't too thrilled with Greg Fitz constantly bugging me about anything and everything, but on stage, we worked well together,
Overall, I liked the spirituality of Quazar. We were from the church, and we freely incorporated the gospel sound into our songs.
As the word had always been a mystery to me, and there were a few ways in how it had been used by this point, I asked, why the choice? Who came up with the name Quazar? What did the name mean to the band, and why was it chosen?
Glenn Goins came up with the name Quazar, and he designed our album cover. I thought of it as the brightest star in the universe. It was Glenn's idea, and we agreed with him. We all liked the name Quazar, too. We thought the name set us apart from other funk bands like Cameo, The Funk Connection, The Ohio Players, The Isley Brothers, and others.
Quazar went on to perform a decent number of live shows before Glenn decided the time was right for an album. The group was tight. The music? Unique enough. And the lineup strong. Pichena describes their live shows vividly and vibrantly.
They were big fun. We laughed, we grooved, we were one. We really had a spiritual vibe happening, and everybody felt it. Everything was on point. We all wanted to please Glenn, so we gave our all. I was in love with my life and excited about the chance to be working with Glenn Goins, a gifted genius who could sing down the heavens any time. I got along well with Kevin, Glenn's younger brother. Pretty much all of the guys. Except Greg Fitz. He was the only one who got on my nerves every time we were together.
Entering the studio, Glenn had a specific vision for how the album had to sound and how to come across. With their sound refined after countless hours of rehearsals and gigging, Quazar stepped into the studio. The group was explosive. Up to 10 members in a highly talented lineup that were all prepared to help Goins bring his dream into the real, physical, and auditory world. Players doubled as technicians and producers, as Goins oversaw and spearheaded the project forward with great passion and skill. After all, this was his baby, an album that would finally let him and all the other hard-working musicians shine in one fantastic record. It was a long time coming, and he had finally got here. Glenn also played several additional roles, contributing his skill with guitar, bass, and drums on some tracks, as well as providing background vocals. Pichena recalls the beginning of the multiple month-long endurance test that would be the recording of Quazar.
We started recording during the fall of 1977 at Studio A in Dearborn, Michigan. Initially, we were recording for Westbound Records, and we stayed in Detroit for about 2 months. Since I had some church friends there, I stayed with them during the Thanksgiving holidays. I liked working on the new funk songs and adding lyrics whenever I could. Doing that was often a battle with Glenn because he had already made up his mind as to what he wanted the lyrics to say, so almost all of our arguments were about the lyrics, not the music.
So, how does the music sound? Well, before we take an in-depth look into the tracks on this LP, we're going to go over a few things first. Format, presentation, and then the music. To begin reviewing the album, we need to take a look at the format it came on. The album was released in the fall of 1978, so it was naturally released on vinyl. An initial favourite on the album of mine, Funk and Roll, Dancing in the Funkshine, was also released as a single, with Savin' My Love for a Rainy Day on the B-side. Alongside the LPs, you also have a cassette release, which is without a doubt the strangest item in my Quazar collection. Not because it has anything different about it, it doesn't. It's the same album, just on a cassette. But for some reason, I can't find any other cassette of this album being sold over the years. I bought this off eBay in around 2015, and I'm glad I did, because I've not seen one other cassette copy of this album for sale, ever. This is the jewel in my collection, alongside some of the outtake recordings, but I'll get onto those in another video. Next up are the CD releases, none of which I have, because insanity can only stretch so far. Peavine Records of Japan allegedly did the first CD release of the album back in 1991, but went out of print shortly after. You'll have to take that lightly though, as I can't find any other references to this aside from on the Wikipedia page, which already has some incorrect information on it. BBR Records, however, re-released the record widely on CD in 2012, which they dubbed the Expanded Edition. This version of the album just included the single versions of Funk and Roll, Saving My Love for a Rainy Day, and Funk with a Bigfoot. As mentioned though, I don't own this release, because my insanity can only spend so much on the same music for collection purposes alone. Next up, the presentation. How does this album come together conceptually? While Quazar isn't as concept-heavy as the universe created by Parliament-Funkadelic, which even then is hard to follow for many listeners, the album still features really beautiful artwork on both the front and back, and in some editions, inner sleeve content. The album cover, designed by Glenn himself, features the band logo in the center, with its custom, stylized lettering backed by a heavenly white glow, engulfing the text in outer space. This clearly represents the group's, and especially Glenn's, gospel influences. While still staying true to the outer space sci-fi theme, Parliament-Funkadelic married to the genre. Overall, the cover is nice, simple, elegant, and showing off what I believe to be Glenn's inspirations. Looking at the back of the record, we now get a bit more information, the track listing, legal info, etc. But the main centerpiece is a striking globe composed of stars, with more white glow emanating from behind. This may reference Bootsy's Rubber Band in some way, whom Glenn and the other members would have worked with in Parliament-Funkadelic, but that's just my interpretation. It could also be interpreted as a religious symbol, signifying again the church-like sound of this album, while still being futuristic and funky. Even if it's only meant to look nice, it does its job as the album is simplistic but still iconic, as many album covers in the funk genre were at the time. In my copies, there's nothing spectacular about what's inside, just a plain sleeve along with a record, which I believe is the original because I couldn't find any evidence to suggest this LP came with anything different, aside from that one photo, whose photographer I'm slightly jealous of. But how does this record sound? Funk with a Bigfoot is the first track on the album, and it's a solid starter for this surrealistic, funk-infused gospel record. It starts out with some really great drumming to get you warmed up, and that's the real centerpiece of this track. It's an intense and intricate song that shows off Jerome Bigfoot Braley's talent on the kit. It's a hard-hitting thumper with some pretty unexpected and experimental changes that show off Quazar's sound really well, but don't spoil the rest of the record for you. Next up is the first track I ever heard, Funk with a Capital G. This song is where the band really let loose and start tearing up both their instruments and vocals. Sections of this song are wound up so tight that it runs like clockwork the whole way through. A driving bass and guitar line drive the song forward with a catchy tune, as Quazar's choir of backing and lead vocalists take center stage. Making it seem like you've walked into some kind of crazy nightclub full of intergalactic funk lovers all singing the same song in their own unique way. While I wasn't really a fan when I first put it on, Funk with a Capital G has grown to be one of my all-time favorites. Everyone, please rise. Third track in, and now we're at the main single, Funk and Roll, Dancing in the Funk Shine. This is probably the best known song from this almost unknown album, where the group hit it hard on the one, as any head-nodding funk tunes do. This one is similar to the style they take up in the previous two tracks, but with more of a repetitive structure, similar to Parliament's We Want the Funk, but with a more brass-based sound. Again, the drums are a centerpiece here, with them and the vocalist taking center stage in the intro as gradually other instruments are introduced. The majority of this song is strong, albeit pretty repetitive. I can remember this is the one I enjoyed most when I was younger, mostly due to its almost disco sound, lyrics, and repetitive structure. It's good and is still an iconic track, but over time it makes less of an impact. And you can see why this was the one to get the casual listener's attention. But thankfully, the next track makes up for where Funk and Roll falls short, and shows off a lot more of Quazar's ability.
Mother. Freak.
Working on the Building is the fourth and final track before you have to flip over the record, and it's here that Quazar's sound really finds its feet. It's got the catchy funk groove, but has more of a stripped down and church-esque sound. The vocals on this track are far more gospel-esque, and just over the 2 minute mark, you get a seriously funked up breakdown section. Clapping hands and reverberating vocals give you the feeling that this song is something from an outer space church, with an experimental and tight funk band that plays right alongside the choir. This song is where Quazar really finds that nice balance between the soulful sound of gospel and funk, and the next song follows the same feeling. Up until now, the songs on Quazar have been mostly about the musicianship. The prior tracks all have vocals, but they don't really tell much of a story. It's mostly phrases and variations of different lyrics repeated for the purpose of just conveying a catchy melody. Which isn't a bad thing, but there haven't been many songs that you could really sing along to yet. This changes though with Your Loving Is Easy, first track on the B-side of the LP. I like your style. It's another song straight from the outer space cathedral, just like Working on the Building, but features a consistent set of lyrics, making it easier to sing along to. Unlike prior tracks, this has more of a set verse and chorus, Glenn Goins taking the mic and showing off his vocal range and style a lot more as the lead vocalist. It's a good one, with some eccentric keyboard work in the background done by as many as 3 keyboardists from the band lineup.
Thank you.
A number one favourite of mine is on the way now. Titled Love Me Baby, this song takes the craziness of the band and mellows it out a little, as Pichena snatches the mic to pelt out a powerful love ballad of sorts.
Come on, love me baby, like you did before. You know how to please, you keep me asking for more. Love me baby, baby, oh, love me baby, oh, oh, I told you to do me, love me baby.
The vocals from Pichena are a real treat to hear after the more dominating male vocals on prior songs. She was definitely present in prior tracks, as Quazar goes for that more choir-styled collection of alien-esque voices. Love Me Baby, however, is something that sticks out, and introduces us to the rest of the album effectively as we get into a more experimental and unpredictable side of the record. Speaking of which, the last three songs here are some of the most unique in Quazar's musical universe. Savin' My Love for a Rainy Day is a classic funk love song, with not too much to speak about. It's a fine song, with some good male choir backing vocals and basic instrumentation. Basic by Quazar standards, that is. Although my love for this album is undying, this is probably my least favourite track. But the final two songs are anything but. Starlight Circus kicks in and haunting, shivery vocals start almost immediately. The song sounds almost as if it were being played in a decaying circus that's hit the end of the road. It's on its last legs, and so are the player's instruments. Everything is in tune, of course, but the piano melody that gets almost interrupted by a standout bassline throughout just throws you off when you think you're finally getting into it. It's a strange track that all culminates in a mysterious finale where you would think the performers of the song were just trying to get it over with so they can all drink in their caravans parked up next to the big top tent, all the while still having a magical side to it that evokes the reality of what we're used to in fairgrounds: lights, wonder, and imagination. Closing Quazar is probably the best track on the entire record, Shades of Quaze. What sets this apart from everything else is just how different it is in style and tone. It's an almost 5 minute long jazz funk track that keeps hitting you again and again with inspired sections of futuristic, yet faithfully funky instrumentation. Fittingly, it sounds like somewhat of a goodbye from the group, until they see you again next time. Everyone and everything is tighter than ever, releasing the tension every so often towards the end in a double burst of shouting brass horns and slapping bass in the background. The song begins to fade away as the band hit a new section, continuing on in their own little world, as it seems you're flying away from them. They hope you'll come back, of course, but only when they've got something new for you to hear. So let's round this off. Is it worth checking out? Well, I mean, you've watched up to this much history and detail on it that I'm sure you don't think I'll say it's terrible. Summing the entire experience up into one word, I would describe Quazar as masterful. It's a great listening experience for anyone into late 70s funk, and features enough originality to be set aside from the other solo projects that came from the same time. While other projects like Mutiny were strong, Quazar seems more original and put together because it's clearly Glenn's vision. Everything here is clearly controlled and carefully planned out to create the exact picture Goins had in his head, which is a contrasting statement when you consider the insane sound of the album. It's nothing groundbreaking, but it does what it wants to do and does it well. It blends church-like soul with an array of talented musicians and artists to create a funk album that deserves its place amongst the stars. It's not without its flaws though, and has its less impactful tracks, but even those are strong alone to the casual listener, and are needed so you can appreciate the other ones even more. It's not a story-driven album, nor does it ever claim to be one, but it would be nice if the almost religious imagery on the back cover was expanded upon. The music sounds like something from a far-off galactic cathedral, being performed as if it's a service at times. The band could have used this idea and created a narrative of their own, spanning different future albums and being expanded on through live shows with more outlandish but stylized imagery. If I were leading the group, I would have gone a lot more into what Quazar was through even just a little piece of paper included with the album. Perhaps Quazar as a band could have been the messengers from their own world, an alien religious organization, or even the masters of their own private universe. A little far-fetched, but it just proves that I want to see more out of the group. I want to see where they'll go with their next project and how they'll expand from this introductory piece. That's what it is in the end, and I'm more than happy with it. It's an introduction to a group with an exceptional amount of talent behind it and a unique take on the funk genre, mixing in a plethora of sounds, effects, and fresh ideas into this gift seemingly from beyond our solar system. So, why has nobody talked about it? While recording Quazar's album, Glenn became ill with Hodgkin's disease, a type of lymphoma which is a blood cancer originating from the lymphatic system, the thing that helps the immune system fight any infections and dispose of waste. If found early, it's one of the most treatable forms of cancer. Today, July 1978, Glenn Goins has been in and out of hospital almost daily, mostly unable to perform with Quazar due to his worsening status. The group are in Philadelphia, performing at a gig, as Glenn lies in a bed. Pete Chenner recalls this show with vivid detail.
I swore that I saw him in the crowd cheering us on that beautiful, sunny day in Philly in July 1978. But I found out later that it wasn't him. After our concert ended in Philadelphia, we had a little celebration at a fan's pad. Someone told me that he wasn't there, that he was in the hospital. You're kidding me, I saw him in the crowd today, I declared. No you didn't, Glenn's in the hospital. Well, give me the phone number, I'm gonna call and see how he's doing. Why did I do that? I telephoned the hospital and inquired about Glenn's status. To my horror, the nurse said, Mr. Glenn Goins has just expired. I screamed as I hung up the phone. Everybody crowded around me as I incoherently screamed and cried about his sudden death. Everybody was in tears. I couldn't stop crying. I left the place and hopped on a Trailways bus to Salisbury, Maryland, to visit with my parents. I went to church there the next day and cried all through the Sunday morning church service. I mourned for Glenn for about 5 crazy years. I think I was a little traumatized too, because I couldn't trust anybody.
Glenn Goins' main focus in Quazar was the music and his friends helping him to make it a reality, The album he and the group had worked so hard on was in the final recording stages, though he would never get to see its completion or release. Glenn Goins' life was taken by blood cancer on July 29th, 1978. The remaining members of Parliament-Funkadelic were shaken and dedicated their multi-platinum record, One Nation Under a Groove, to him. He left us at the age of 24. But while Parliament-Funkadelic could at least continue to perform, Quazar was left without their leader. The sudden and unexpected death of Glenn threw a spanner into the works which the group alone would have to retrieve. Struck by an inexplicable amount of grief and mourning their lost friend, the group were left with an unfinished album, a mountain of legal trouble from another record company, and no one willing to point the way out. Legal trouble was a constant presence while recording the album. Quazar initially recorded songs for Westbound Records, who wouldn't allow them to release those tracks on their upcoming LP due to the band now being signed with Arista. The band pulled themselves together quickly. Quazar was a year-long passion project in the making that the band committed to finish in their friend's honour. The only problem being that almost everything had to be re-recorded. With a set release date looming over them and only a few months away, Quazar started scrambling to finish their debut masterwork. One song might not have ever seen release, had Glenn's absence not sparked such dedication to the project.
My song Love Me Baby was included on our album after Glenn's death, because Jerome Braley, our producer for the album, needed one more song to complete it. I think the guys liked the song too because they sang the backup vocals on it. I was still so devastated by Glenn's sudden demise that I recorded that song lying on the floor, crying between takes. We had to re-record our first album 10 days after his death.
Quazar released their self-titled album in the fall of 1978, to positive critical response and a modest amount of attention from the media. The Washington Afro-American covered the release and some of the hardships in an article called Quazar, Strong Waves from the Stars. While the album did get some attention for its popular single Funk and Roll, and the group were starting to see the beginning of a successful career together, more complications began to arise as they started a promotional tour.
Quazar's album release party was just a blur. I was still in tears. There was nothing to celebrate. Our giant was gone. There was a hollowness, a void that no one could fill. We had to re-record that album within 10 days after his death, so we were singing and playing through tears. As time went on, I became the legal secretary for the band, creating and typing up all of our performance contracts. I knew exactly how much we were making for our performances, so I kept urging the guys to demand more money for their gigs, but they weren't concerned about that. They were just glad to be getting paid, so they ignored my protests. We were booked to go on our first promo tour through the South, and for me, it became a living hell. I shut down emotionally, and I kept to myself, praying to God. The guys were mourning deeply, too. You could see it in their faces. Now we were performing because we had to, not because we wanted to. The thrill of performing together was over. We missed Glenn and we were lost. To make things worse, Glenn's older brother, Tyrone, was released from jail just after Glenn passed, and he joined Quazar as our road manager. One day, while we were traveling to Louisville, Kentucky, he put his silver-plated gun on the table and told me, "When you get up on stage tonight, just know that I will have this gun pointed at your back, and if you act up, I'm gonna shoot you. I was beyond scared. Numbed might have been a better way to describe how I felt. Over 1,000 miles away from my family, and now I was verbally threatened. After our concert opening up for Chaka Khan, I had to ride all the way back to New York City with Tyrone and his girlfriend, and I never said a dissenting word. He talked about his plans for Quazar, but I said nothing. Silently, I prayed and prayed to God. I said, "Lord, if you just get me back to New York safely, I will never do this again. I will quit this band." The next day after I returned to New York City, I called my lawyer and asked him to draft a letter to Arista Records requesting my release from Quazar and for expense money because, once again, I was homeless and had to find a place to stay right away. And I got it! I stayed at the Martha Washington Hotel until I found a small apartment on West 84th Street in NYC. 2 weeks later, I got the news that some members of Quazar had gotten into a fight while touring somewhere down south, and the band broke up.
So you might be thinking, well, why now? And who even are you? Some boy from the middle of nowhere wants to make a whole documentary about this obscure funk band from the US over 40 years after it disbanded because he found out about it by accident? Sounds a little crazy. Well, there's a greater story to it than that. After listening to that first song, Funk with a Capital G, and turning it off because I didn't like it all that much, I went back to it. It was alien, a little bit different, but still had a flavour of disco and that 70s sound that I knew I liked. As I got listening to more tracks from the album, I found myself enjoying it the more I listened to it, which eventually led me to a group named Parliament-Funkadelic. That group got me into a more rock-centric sound, which then led to influencing me when I was asked to be the singer of someone's rock band. I had no clue what I was doing, I didn't really sing all that much, but hey, I would take anything offered to me because I didn't have any friends at the time. That then led me to listen to Marilyn Manson, and then David Bowie, and all the stars aligned to connect back to this one central point, which gave me a first taste of a different genre of music. To put it shortly, this album and group was the starting point for my future taste in music, and influenced me to such a degree that I would end up being associated with this name for many years to come. But this isn't my story. It's theirs. Quazar was a group with colossal potential, and a sound that took influences from pioneers of the genre, in one of the most turbulent yet exciting eras to be in the music business. With an experienced crew, the young captain took the wheel and charted a course, plotting their journey ahead to join the stars up above. The mission went well at first, until reality came knocking after leaving the Earth. The crew knew something was wrong, but the captain continued, determined to push on. They flew over heaven that day, their ship in bright orange and scorching red flames, burning hotter than the brightest of suns, their fuel ran low and they no longer were one. The captain had lost, and his crew kept fighting alone. Left without guidance and any navigation, they knew by now they couldn't get back home. Barreling through the cosmos, trying to reach out, they sent off their signal that by few would ever be found. And long after disappearing, their message still stands as a blackened star, forgotten in a long-lost land, where the obscure come to rest and quietly be forgotten, as their light, while now faded, travels far to somewhere uncommon. But these stars are not dead yet, and you can still hold them tight if you look up and spot them on a pitch black night. Because some never die, as their light shines so far. The brightest thing from another universe, simply named Quazar.